Do you have someone, are you someone brand new here?
Yes.
Some of you are brand new here, okay. So, but I think it will not be a problem for you to follow what's going to be here. I hope not, otherwise you can ask afterwards. And actually we have, after, you know, our program today is that we have a lecture for 1 hour now. And then at we will have singing and dancing, kirtan. Called from 4:30 until like 5 o'clock. Then we serve out a big feast, prasad, or big vegetarian food that has been offered to Krishna at 5 o'clock. And at 6 o'clock, for 1 hour, those who are interested to want to have more discussions, we go up to another room, because this room will be cleaned after the prasad, the feast. Then we go to another room and we just sit like, and you know, that's a very informal talk, you know, whatever discussions and questions and like that someone might have, we'll talk about. So, but this is from the Bhagavad Gita. It's in the end of the Bhagavad Gita, where Krishna, he is telling to Arjuna. Of course, you have here Krishna standing up and Arjuna sitting in the chariot. And here Krishna says, Isvara sarabhuta nam vrittisya junatistati ramayan sarabhuta ni yantra rudani mayaya. The Supreme Lord is situated in everyone's heart, O Arjuna, and is directing the wanderings of all the entities who are seated as on a machine made of the material energy. And I'll just leave it at that. And then I will give a speech on matter, mind and consciousness. But in the end, you can see how it ties together with this verse from the Bhagavad Gita. I hope you can make that clear. It's a presentation I've given in different contexts. It's a little, you know, science, when science is fun and interesting, and a little far out science also, you know, some far out things about science, because actually there are many scientists who are observing many, many far out things, which are not easy to explain simply by materialistic science, that everything that existing is simply atoms and molecules and that's all there is. So there's actually a lecture on that, that actually scientifically there's more than just molecules and atoms in, you know, in the universe and in nature. And it's something that many, many scientists actually have observed. Here is one such scientist. His name is Dean Radin. He's a physicist from Princeton University in America. And he published in 1989 some studies on experiments with random number generator. Now, a random number generator is a machine that is coming up with ones and zeros randomly. It's actually, in one sense, just an electronic throwing of a coin. You know, you throw coins and you have heads and tails. So here, this machine instead is coming up with ones and zeros. But it's exactly the same thing. And if you throw enough coins, or if you turn out enough ones and zeros, you'll expect that the distribution will be 50 to 50%, no, equal amount of each. And but he was studying, have been done experiments where test subjects, students generally, have been asked to try to influence a number generator to only come up with ones and no zeros, just influence with their mind, you know, think like that, try to see if you can affect the machine. So that's of course not possible by, you know. You know the laws of physics, that's not just because you think you cannot affect a machine like that. So that's, you know, we know that. Still, Radin, he came up, you know, he was actually, it was an enormous amount of data he had. It was 597 experiments from 1959 to 1987. And he found there actually that instead of being 50 to 50, the distribution was 51 to 49%. That doesn't sound like much, but with this actually this enormous amount of data, the chance for this just being random, you know, is actually one in a trillion. That is one out of 10 with 12 zeros after. So I mean, there is an effect. This is not chance. So what is going on? What is going on here? Lenin himself, he stated here, you know, there are disagreements over how to interpret the evidence. But the fact is that virtually all scientists who studied the evidence, including the hard-nosed skeptics, now agree that something interesting is going on that merits serious scientific attention. So there's a lot of science I could point to that nature is not just atoms and molecules, there's something more going on, and some of our consciousness can affect matter and can affect nature. And actually there are an awful lot of scientists who have studied that. It's not very well known. You don't read that in illustrated science or things like that, but it's actually there. And I could give many. I'm just going to give a few examples, but actually there's so many examples. Here's one very interesting experiment that was made. It was made by this English biologist, Rupert Sheldrake. And he made an experiment where he was discussing if dogs, do dogs have a sixth sense? Who has a dog here? Has had a dog? You have a dog. Does it have a sixth sense? You don't know.
Absolute.
You say absolute. Dogs have a sixth sense.
Can have
a sixth sense. They can sense things, which they shouldn't be able. They cannot hear or smell, but sometimes they have a feeling. Something. Someone is out there, and they start barking. Some dogs like that. Anyway, he wanted to find out that. So what he did, he actually got in touch with this English woman, Pamela Smart, and her dog, Jaiti. And they were, now, actually, to mention a little about Pamela, she was in the 90s a fairly young woman living in Manchester in England. She was living with her parents, and she had a dog, Jaiti, and every day she was going for work. She was leaving at a particular time in the morning, and every day in the afternoon she'd come back at a fixed time. And ever she was coming back, then the dog would be by the door and waiting, seeing the dog knew now she's coming home. And when the door opened, the dog would of course jump and wag the tail, and like dogs do. And the parents and everyone thought, because the dog knows she comes home at that time every day, so therefore the dog knows that she's coming home. But then she was laid off. She lost her job, she became unemployed, and then she was no longer leaving at any particular time or coming back at any regular time. She would leave and come back any time of the day. And the parents had noticed the dog seems to be knowing that she's coming back. And at that time, in a newspaper, they read Sheldrake was advertising for test subjects with dogs. So then they contacted him and said, our dog seems to be really, you know, special. So then they got in touch, and they made over 2 years, they made 200 experiments. And the experiments were that every time that Pamela would leave, she would turn on a video camera that was pointed towards the entrance door. You just keep on recording, and it was time-coded, so you could see what time. So you actually be able to record when the dog was at the door. And then she would be out, and whenever she would start returning home, she would simply note it in a book. That was the experiment. Did that 200 times. Sometimes she would be out for short errands, sometimes most of the day. Sometimes it was close, sometimes 50 or 100 kilometers away. Sometimes she would drive in her own car, sometimes bus, trains, taxis, sometimes she herself would decide, now I'm going home. Sometimes the agreement was, you don't go home before I send you a message, and Rupert Sheldrake would send her a message, now you go home. In this way, 200 experiments were performed. And the result was This was published in 2000 in Journal of Scientific Exploration in an article called "A Dog That Seems to Know When Its Owner Is Coming Home: Videotape Experiments and Observations." And the result was that normally, most of the time, the dog would be 5 to 10% the time by the door. But when she was on her way home, then the dog would be by the door 50 to 60% of the time. So there was a bit daunting. I mean, the dog knew she was on her way home. So So Schelder concludes there must be dogs must have like a telepathic sense. It's a if she's 50-60 kilometers away in a bus or train, the dog cannot hear she's coming home or smell she's coming home. Anyway, it's Manchester, it's a heavy, congested city, lots of noise and things like that. There's no way the dog can know, but the dog knew. And so many experiments have been not only nowadays, but actually if you go back even like 100 years back, for example, many scientists were making experiments like that. And I can mention many famous scientists. I'm just going to mention a couple of very famous scientists like that. One such famous couple of scientists were Marie and Pierre Curie. Who knows them? They're famous. I mean, if you had a list of the 20 most or the 10 most famous scientists in the 20th century, probably they would be on the list. They were discoverers of radioactivity, they were discoverers of radium. She was Polish, he was French. They were living in Paris, working at the University of Paris, and very famous scientist, got the Nobel Prize. She has got the Nobel Prize twice. Pierre Curie only got once because he died in 1906, and she lived on for many years after that. And but what many do not know is that they not only investigate radioactivity, they were also into spiritism. And due to their studies of spiritism, once Pierre Curie, he stated here, "There is, according to me, a completely new domain of facts and physical states of space of which we presently have no idea." So here describes what it is they were experimenting with, which makes him think like that. He wrote in 1905, "We had at the Psychological Society a few seances with a medium, Eusapio Palladino. It was very interesting, and truly those phenomena that we had witnessed seemed to us not to be some magical tricks. A table lifted 4 feet above the floor, movements of objects, feelings of hands that pinched you or caressed you, apparitions of light. All this in a room arranged by us with a small number of spectators, all well known and without the presence of a possible accomplice. Cheating would only be possible if the medium had extraordinary abilities as a magician. But how to explain the different phenomena when we are holding her hands and legs and the lighting of the room is sufficient to see everything going on?" So this was what they were experimenting with. The record still in the University of Paris somewhere in archives there. And is it true? Well, we know they wrote, they saw it. That's what we know. That's why Pierre Curie, he wrote this. There's a completely new domain of facts and physical states of which we presently have no idea. Here, another famous scientist who got involved with that was not Darwin. Everyone knows Darwin, so you can ask, was he also involved in the paranormal spiritistic research? The answer is no, he was not. But the scientist who was very close to him was very involved with it. This is Alfred Russel Wallace. I don't know how many of you know about Alfred Russel Wallace, but actually, of course, you know Darwin and the theory of evolution. But the theory of evolution actually was not only Darwin's idea, it was Wallace. There were two scientists who published the theory of evolution. The other was Wallace. So actually they were colleagues, very close colleagues. But later on they parted, because Wallace, he was actually making spiritistic research, so much that Darwin got very angry. And Darwin, he wrote to Wallace once, I hope that you're aware that you're murdering our common child, the theory of evolution, because Darwin was a very strict materialist and he wanted to be able to explain life simply materially, you know, just laws of physics and chemistry, that's all. But this experiments that Wallace were conducting showed something else, and Darwin did not like that. Anyway, that didn't stop Wallace at all. Here, Wallace, he writes here, I ought to state that for 25 years I have been an utter skeptic as to the existence of any preterhuman or superhuman intelligences, and that I never for a moment contemplated the possibility that the marvels related by the spiritualists could be literally true. If I have now changed my opinion, it is simply by the force of evidence. It's from no dread of annihilation that I've gone into this subject. It's from no inordinate longing for eternal existence that I've come to believe in facts which render this highly probable if they do not actually prove it. So, you know, so he was making experiments which convinced him that we must be eternal. There's something more than matter. He was, and then mainly it was the same kind of experiments that the Curies were making in France with the media, you know, persons who seemingly were able to affect matter with their minds. He was working with one medium called Daniel Douglas Hume. He was very powerful, it seemed like, and Wallace, together with another quite famous British scientist named William Crookes, made experiments with Humes. They would come to him unannounced. That was the agreement. They come to him unannounced, knock on the door, and say, "Okay, come with us." And then they would bring Hume to a place where he had never been before, and he didn't know what it was. And then there he would perform, you know, in front of them. And then thus Wallace and Crookes and other scientists were seeing how. Again, tables were lifting off the floor, musical instruments were playing without anyone touching them. At one point, they saw Hume levitating up in the air, out of an open window on second floor, flowed out, coming through another window, and down again, like that. So this was what they, and he was, you know, made not only Hume, but many other media like that, he was making experiments with them. He said it's happening, it's actually true. So therefore he concludes that the world and the whole material universe exist for the purpose of developing spiritual beings. Death is simply a transition from material existence to the first ray of spirit life. So that was what he concluded. He became convinced that actually he believes in evolution. But it was a spiritual evolution where spirit souls are evolving, and the physical evolution is simply reflecting the spiritual evolution, which is something completely different from Darwin. And that's maybe why he's not so famous. But he's much more interesting, actually. And but to my knowledge, he didn't make that. He had experiments. He had experiments where, for example, he got messages from his brother who had died many years ago and like that. So he wasn't in contact with dead spirits. But there has been a lot of other experiments where actually, you know, showing that that we are different. You know, we actually do survive. There is a life after death and so on. And that becomes, especially if we start looking at what consciousness is, because consciousness is very interesting. First of all, we should be aware that we are all conscious. And that this is what actually makes us alive. We can see if we have it, you know, we have someone, in one moment he or she is alive, next moment he or she is dead. What is the difference? The difference is there is a conscious I in the living body, and in the dead body there is no conscious I. That's actually the only difference. The physical, you know, the body there still, but, you know, there's a complete difference like day and night. There's a conscious I when the body is alive, there's no conscious I when the body is dead. So what is that consciousness? Is it just brain waves? Like most scientists still believe there's actually a lot of science that points to that is something more is going on. And there's scientists who concluded that it must be like that. Here is Thomas Huxley, was a famous contemporary of Darwin and very great Darwinist. But still he said here, I understand the main tenet of materialism to be that there is nothing in the universe but matter and force, and that all the phenomena of nature are explicable by deduction from the properties assignable to these two primitive factors. It seems to me pretty plain that there is a third thing in the universe, namely consciousness, which I cannot see to be matter or force or any conceivable modification of either. Here's another scientist. This is Eugene Wigner. He's a Nobel laureate and quantum physicist, and you know, a modern. I mean, he died in 1995, but he lived in our modern era. And he said that two kinds of reality or existence: the existence of my consciousness and the reality or existence of everything else. The latter reality is not absolute, but only relative. I don't know if you understand what he's saying, but he's saying actually, first we're conscious, and then matter and everything else is just something that we are conscious of. Therefore, consciousness must be more real than matter. It's actually the same argument if you take the history of science in Europe. One of the founders of European science was a French philosopher, basically, René Descartes, who wanted to find out what can we be certain of, what can be 100% sure of. And in order to do that, he started doubting everything. That was his process. He doubted everything. You know, and we can doubt everything. I could doubt that you're here. Maybe it's just an illusion that you're here. And so on. So he kept on doubting like that. And finally he reached one thing that could not be doubted. You know what that is?
Consciousness.
Yeah, but that boy just jumping in too quick. But it's correct.
Cogito ergo sum.
He said cogito ergo sum, which means?
I think beforehand.
Yeah, actually it doesn't mean think. It actually means...
I cogito.
No, I doubt. I doubt that, you know, he concluded, you know, I can doubt everything, but one thing I cannot be doubt, that is that I'm doubting. That's for sure, I'm doubting. Therefore, that must be real. And therefore, you know, I must exist, I must doubt, I must think, therefore I am. So that was actually, modern science is based on that idea. And Descartes was a dualist, he accepted that. The self is just a soul, and then there's matter, and it's two different things, and you believe in reincarnation, like that. But that's, so this is similar to the, you know, Wigner's point here also, that if you actually look at consciousness, it is the first experience we have. Here's another, he's still living, Brian Josephson is he's a British quantum physicist, and he's a Nobel laureate, who wrote, science needs to try to understand the observer and to respond vigorously to the challenge of consciousness research. Physics may have moved too fast toward a tempting conclusion that the laws of quantum physics are the ultimate description of reality and thrown out the crucial and subtle intelligence of the observer as a part of this process. And now we're talking about contemporary, but this discussion about consciousness being deeper than just matter is actually an old discussion. It's actually as old as European philosophy is. Here is an excerpt from a book called Phaedo. It's written by Plato. I think everyone knows Greek philosopher Plato and Socrates. And actually, Phaedo is an amazing book. It's the last day of Socrates. You know, you may know that Socrates, he was condemned to death in Athens, actually for misleading the youth of Athens. That was his crime. And he was there was a court case against him, and he was convicted. He was found guilty, and he was given a choice. You can either withdraw your statements, or you will be executed. And then in his response, Socrates, he was a philosopher, so he was considering that we know death may or may not may be good or may be bad. We're not sure. Lying is always bad. So therefore, the safe thing is to accept death, because it might be good. Lying is always bad. So he said, so I'll lie. And then he was not executed immediately, because he was in prison for quite some, I think even a couple of months, many weeks at least, because there was part of the Greek religion, there was a certain holy ship that had to return from Egypt to Greece before he could be executed, before anyone could be executed. When that ship was out of harbor, they no longer could be executed. So they were waiting and waiting like that, and Socrates was in prison. And then, one day they spotted out on the horizon, now the ship is coming, and then the next day Socrates will be executed. So we're in that day, Socrates will be executed. And this is where Phaedo starts, and his friends, they come and they want to have a last talk with Socrates. And it's interesting how they come there. They speak with the prison guard, and they ask to see Socrates. And the prison guard says, sorry, it's not possible because he's still sleeping. Which is probably surprising, because he's just going to be executed in a few hours, but he's sleeping. And then finally he wakes up, and then they get to speak with him, and he's very happy, because of course if you sleep, have a good nice rest, and you feel happy, of course. So he's very happy, he's very relaxed, he's smiling, but of course his friends, they're all uptight. And they say, they want Socrates, we can get you out of here. We have a plan, we can bring you to another country, you can have a new life, we can get you out of here, we can break the prison garden like that. But Socrates says, why should we do that? It's wrong. It's morally wrong, it's ethically wrong, we should not do that. So there's an argument like that, but then they say, but you're going to die. Socrates said, I'm not going to die. And then they have a very interesting discussion on why the self must survive the body. And Socrates gives some very strong arguments. The main argument, what he gives, anyone knows what is the argument? And you want to hear?
Yay!
Yeah, he gives a strong argument, a very convincing argument. The body is always changing and the self is always the same. You may recognize this from Bhagavad Gita. So actually Socrates uses the same argument. He uses more words, but the same argument. So here, this is a conclusion. This is the last thing that happens just before he's executed. Very well then, in the light of all that we have said, both now and before, to which class do you think that the soul bears a closer resemblance and relation? Cadus, I think, Socrates, that even the dullest person would agree from this line of reasoning that the soul is in every possible way more like the invariable than the variable. Socrates, and the other, and the body, say this, or Cadus, to the other. So, and personally, I think that, of all the proofs that there is life after death, that we survive the body, this is the best. It's the Bhagavad Gita. Socrates, and you find it also in other philosophers using that argument. Because that is very direct. We can all immediately, close our eyes, and we can look inwards, and we can analyze, and yes, I am the same, and the body has changed through all the years I can remember, but the body, I'm still the same. And I think that's a very immediate, direct experience, that I am different from the body. And I'm completely satisfied that most of you may also be completely satisfied with that. However, I also find that some are not